Praise God, brothers and sisters. This is Brother Patrick again. Praise God. Oh, I wanted to tell you about a vision I just had a moment ago. And as you guys know, the Lord has been leading me about Israel. And I saw, brothers and sisters, a mighty angel who was seated, and that mighty angel stood up. Now, anybody that's read the book of Daniel, chapter 12, we know that in the end times, Gabriel told Daniel that your prince will stand up. You know, Archangel Michael will stand up. This is a signal. It's time for the tribulation period, brothers and sisters. And I saw that mighty angel descend. And when he got down to the earth, brothers and sisters, I saw David, King David, as a teenager. At the time he killed Goliath. And then I saw, which I mean, like I say, I wasn't even praying about anything like this. And the Lord keeps giving me stuff about Israel. Praise God. I mean, that's the word I gave the other day. The Lord would keep talking to me about Israel, and he is. When I'm not even nowhere near thinking about it. And that angel, the Archangel Michael, he took his wings and he put them around David, brothers and sisters. And then he kept going around in a circle like this. He kept going around in a circle like this. And then I heard a Messiah is given. And then I saw the face of Joseph. And the Lord told me, just as Joseph was a Messiah to his people in the day of the famine, so shall the Lord be a Messiah to his people in the day of the tribulation. He will deliver them. He will keep them through. He will keep them through the tribulation, through the storm, through the famine. And then I was just meditating on it and then thinking that a rose by any other name is but a rose, but this rose is a city. Now, what does that mean? The city that is a rose, the rose city is Petra, which in the Bible is called Basra. Now, this is what's going to happen. Contrary to any wacky, nonsensical, demonic doctrines you've heard on the internet, the Bible tells us, you clearly read the dates and everything that's going to happen during the tribulation is laid out. Now, what's going to happen is when the tribulation begins, the two witnesses will appear at Jerusalem, there at the Temple Mount, and they will prophesy that Jesus is the Christ to Israel for that period. Anybody that tries to touch them will be burned up with fire, and it will not rain. There won't be any rain during that time and all those things. As an example, these are some of the signs that points to Elijah as being one of the two witnesses. The other one will either be Enoch or Moses. Okay, and there's a debate about that, and I don't care. It doesn't matter. Anyway, in the middle of the tribulation, after the first 3.5 years, during the first 3.5 years, Israel will not recognize the Antichrist for who he is. In the beginning of the tribulation, they will make a peace deal with him to rebuild the temple. People say, well, Netanyahu will never go along with it. You know why? His backers, as an example, the ultra-Orthodox Jewish people. What do they want more than anything? They want to rebuild the temple. They believe, you can go listen to Chaim Richman, the head of the Temple Mount Faithful and the Temple Mount Institute, these different organizations. You listen to what they say. They believe, and they quote from the Bible, what Jesus quoted the beginning of the verse where it says, my house will be called a house of prayer. The rest of the verse that Jesus did not quote, my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. That's what that Bible verse in the Old Testament says. So those rabbis believe if they rebuild the temple, then world peace will come. It will usher in, you know, the 1,000-year reign. They believe that the Messiah will come. You know, if they build it, he will come. Just like the Field of Dreams. You know, that's what they believe. If they build it, then the Messiah will come. It'll bring in an age of peace. That's why they want to build it. So, even politically in Israel and spiritually, the greatest thing they can do is rebuild that temple. So, when they find out that, oh, we're going to give them half of Jerusalem, and we're going to give them, you know, the Golan Line and whatever and all these parts of Israel in exchange for building the temple, the liberal, hippie, pot-smoking Israelites who are not trying to walk with God, they want peace, and they don't, you know, they, just like the liberals in America, they don't believe there's any such thing as evil. They don't believe that manure smells. And so they're willing to make a deal with the devil just so they can keep on partying and smoking pot and hugging trees and saying, oh, we've got peace. You know, that crowd. Israel's got a huge block of very liberal people. They're going to be right in there with that, whatever. They're ready to make a deal with the devil, like Shimon Peres, who actually, a lot of people don't know this, he went to school at a Jesuit school. That's why he's buddies with the Pope. He was raised in a Jesuit school, and he has that same mindset, this worldly, Mother Earth, New Age, demonic mindset that comes straight through the Jesuits. Go look it up and see what their mindset is and all the things they believe. This is their, you know, the Antichrist spirit. Okay, then you've got the as I just mentioned, the ultra-Orthodox and the religious Jewish people. They're willing to almost do anything to rebuild the temple because they think when they rebuild the temple, the Messiah is going to show up. There'll be world peace. It will be a house of prayer for all nations. Therefore, you know, all the liberals are going to be like, hey, we don't make it just for our God. Let's let the Buddhists come here and pray. Let's let the Hindus come here and pray and all this. It's a house for all nations and all religions. That's what they're going to go for. That's how it's going to be set up. So mid-tribulation, the Antichrist, just prior to that, he will appear as if he's killed. And then it'll appear as if he's resurrected, copying Christ. He will be risen from the dead, like the Messiah, the Christ. He will go to the Temple Mount. After all that time, anyone that tried to touch the witnesses will be killed. But the Antichrist himself, as it says, the beast who came out of the bottomless pit, the first beast, Apollyon, Apollo, Abaddon, the destroyer, you know, as it says, he will enter into perdition. Perdition, and also it says the son of perdition. I'm changing up messages here. I'm trying to tell you who the Antichrist is. It's Apollyon. It says that the beast, the first beast, who came out of the bottomless pit, the captain of the bottomless pit, is Apollyon, the destroyer. It says in Revelation, he will enter into perdition. Perdition is Apollonia, or destruction. Now, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 said he's called the son of Apollonia, the son of destruction. I'm telling you, the spirit of Antichrist is Apollyon. The name is given in Revelation. That's why I have a video on my channel called The Antichrist's Name is Written in the Bible. It's Apollyon. It's Abaddon in Hebrew. The destroyer. He's coming to kill, steal, and destroy all mankind, all who will not be born again. That's what he's coming to do. The destroyer. The fallen angel. That's what's going to happen. The wicked one. Satan. Anyway, brothers and sisters. Mid-trib, after he resurrects the Antichrist, or seemingly resurrects, he will kill the two witnesses. God will give him the power to kill the two witnesses when no one else can do anything with them. And the Bible says, there's in Revelation chapter 11, it says their bodies lay in the streets for 3.5 days. God loves those sevens and 3.5s, which is half of seven. People will give each other presents and celebrate their death, and the whole world will see it. And then the Lord will say to them what he's going to say to us at the rapture. He's going to say, come up here, and they will stand up and then go up into the air, up to heaven, to be with God. And the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. That is why it's probably Enoch and Elijah. Enoch and Elijah are all that I know of that can be the two witnesses. And it's literally two people that will literally be killed. They will literally be resurrected, taken up to heaven. All this false doctrine and nonsense on YouTube about the two witnesses are Jerusalem and Israel, or the New Testament and the Old Testament. There's not going to be Bibles standing and speaking there and calling down fire from heaven and droughts. And there's not going to be two Bibles or two cities and all this stuff that's going to be killed by the Antichrist and be resurrected and God say, come up here and all that. No, 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 no. It's two people. 99% Enoch and Elijah, based on the word of God and the requirement that it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. So mid-trib, he will kill the two witnesses and he'll go into the temple. And then if you go study Hanukkah, go look at the Maccabees, the books that were taken out of the Bible, the Apocrypha books, the book of Maccabees, you will see a shadow and a type of what the Antichrist will do. From Antioch Epiphanes, what he did, the fourth. Antiochus Epiphanes the fourth, what he did. He went into the temple, he sacrificed a pig, put up a statue of Zeus and all this stuff, declared himself to be God. Now the Antichrist will go in there, declare himself to be God. Now, Antiochus Epiphanes IV did that in about 165 BC. Okay? And so there are people in their wacky insanity, theologians, particularly the old Protestant denominations, the Amillennialist people, Presbyterians and whatnot, they will tell you, well, it was already been fulfilled with that guy. But that is so bizarre when Jesus himself, in about 30 AD, about 200 years after Antiochus Epiphanes IV, he said, when you see the abomination that causes desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, you know, notably the mountains. It's a literal place. It's a literal rebuilt temple, and it's when the Antichrist, you can't just take that text and say, oh, you know, we are, you know, some abomination. When if someone takes the mark, in a way that is a figurative way of an abomination. But if you're not a Christian, and you take that, you're not holy. So how are you a holy temple of God if you're not a Christian? So you taking the mark is not an abomination standing in the holy place, because you're not holy if you're not a Christian. And if you're a Christian, you're not going to take the mark. So ungodly people taking the mark is not a holy place being defiled. The temple of God are people who are born again. That's the temple of God. So that doesn't even make any sense at all. And to top it all off, as we read other places in the Bible, what all is going to happen? This is literal events. It's not just these people that flip open the Bible. They got saved yesterday. The archangel Michael led them to the Lord. The next day they're going around saying they're half fallen angel, half man. And this is what it means. That's nonsense. The Bible clearly lays out all kinds of dozens of passages to support that it's a literal event. They're going to divide the land of Israel. They're really going to rebuild the temple. There will literally be two witnesses. They will literally be killed. They will literally be resurrected. The Antichrist will literally go in there and perform an abomination, sacrificing a pig or whatever, something like that, declaring himself to be God. And when that happens, all hell is going to break loose in Israel. The nation of Israel, those who do not take the mark, will realize, hey, this guy is from the devil. And they will flee into the wilderness to Bozrah, to Petra, and they will remain there the second half of the tribulation, and God will protect them. That is the literal, real interpretation of the text. And all of this other stuff, secondary stuff, some of it is true to in a metaphoric way and partially true and all that. But what literally is going to happen, that surface text is literally going to happen. All this other stuff is a bunch of nonsense designed to cloud and confuse and make people think they're one of the two witnesses and all this other nonsense that you hear and see and all of the things that's going on. These are all signs of the end times. All of this strong delusions that people have, delusions of grandeur that people have in their minds, is signs of the end times, brothers and sisters. Say about, I'll just say, like I said before, 90% of people that I've talked to since I've been on the YouTube have been great people, you know, great people. But there is a percent of people who, you know, they remind, like I say, it always brings me back to a worldly song because their thinking is not Christian. Brings me back to the old worldly song of Ozzy Osbourne, you know. They're going off the rails on the crazy train. I mean, I don't know what else to say, you know. They're not on the train that's bound for glory. They're on the crazy train, you know, and they got a first class ticket. You know, they're right in the front row of the crazy train. And I mean, I don't know what to say. I'm just laughing about it because I know that, you know, I don't like to stick my finger in a hornet's nest. But, you know, that's the devil. It's just demonic strongholds, brothers and sisters. It's just demonic strongholds. And when you start striking that thing, boy, it's going to squeal like a pig. God bless you, brothers and sisters. God bless. Pray for me.